Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs. As you know, today you have 30th of April 2021, and these lectures are basically useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC or any other government competitive examinations. And nowadays the questions which are specifically asked from the current affairs are very high, so you should read the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express, all right? And you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures also. So these lectures are also very good in terms of providing the comprehensive coverage of your current affairs. Okay, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube. There we upload these lectures on the day-to-day basis. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is related to the Thane module. Okay, the Thane module is basically a part of a space station which the China is planning to launch. Okay, so the Thane module is basically a part, basically a space station, right? That is just like an international space station which have been already been there, right, in the space. So China is also planning to have its own independent space station in the future. So to create the construction of a station, right, by the end of next year, the China has launched a core module, right, a core module of the space station. So first of all, you must understand, this space station which the China is planning to make or planning to complete, right, that will be assembled in the space itself. So the module wise module, their parts, right, that will be sent to the space, and there they will be assembled in order to make the space station, right? And that will be, you know, planning to be completed for the construction for that space station will be the next year itself. Okay, so as I told you that it is basically a part of your a space station which is also known as the Tiangong space station, which the China has basically named for its purpose, right? So the Tiangong space station, which is also known as the Chinese large modular space station, it's basically a planned space station that will be placed in the low earth orbit, right, where the International Space Station is already there. That means the low earth orbit, basically having, you know, the 340 to around 450 kilometers above the earth's surface. So there this space station will be, you know, revolving. Now that is basically about the Tiangong, the space station. There the core module, the Tiange module, have been recently been launched. Now this module have been launched with the help of the Long March 5B Y2 rocket. Okay, so this is a simply a rocket, or you can say it is a vehicle. It is a vehicle that basically carried this Tiane module, which basically blasted off from the Wenchang spacecraft launch site on the coast of the southern island on the province of Henan. Okay, so there this Long March 5B Y2 rocket have been taken this Tiane module to the low earth orbit. Now this Tiane module is basically act as a management and the control hub. So first of all, as I told you, it is basically, you know, it's basically a key part, right? It basically formed the main part, right? It's a core module. So it will be the management and the control hub of the space station, that is the upcoming space station of belong to China, that is Tiangong, right? The Tiangong, in the Chinese term, it is known as the heavenly place, right, which will be placed in the low earth orbit, right? And there in this Tiangong space station, right, there is also the space for docking up to the 3 spacecraft at the time of short stay. So that means up to the 2-3 spacecraft that can be docked along with, you know, the space station for the shorter stay. And if the person or if the astronauts would like to plan for the longer stay, at least 2, you know, the spacecraft can be docked, right, in the case of emergency situation, in the case of supplying of, you know, those items, those, you know, which are required for the astronauts to function over there, right? For that purpose, the spacecraft would be used, right? And it will be basically used for also bringing and, you know, taking down the astronauts from the space station also. Okay, now let us understand about brief about this Long March 5B Y2 rocket. This Long 5 or Long March 5 simple rocket basically is a Chinese heavy lift launch vehicle which is developed by the Chinese Academy of the Launch Vehicle Technology, right? It's a basically the first Chinese launch vehicle which is designed for, you know, taking up, you know, the load or simply a payload capacity of around 25,000 kg, right? So it can take up to the 25,000 kg, right? Basically to the lower orbit and up to the 14,000 kg up to the geostationary transfer orbit. So it's a basically, you know, the heavy launch vehicle belongs to the China. Okay. Next, the Taina, the tiny basically module, which is a basically the core module having the length of 16.6 meters and is at a diameter of around 4.2 meters and it has basically the mass of around 22.5 tons. It is basically the largest spacecraft that has been developed by the China. As the figure or the, you know, the shape of the station, right? Basically is the T shape. That means the space station, which is also known as the Tiangong space station, will be having the T shape. The core module, which is also known as the Tiane module, will be placed at the center, right? And there will be a lab capsules where the labs will be there that will be situated on the each side of this space station. Okay. Now the space station will operate in the low Earth orbit because in the low Earth orbit it is you know easy to take. Right, you know, the most accurate, you know, the basically the figures related to the Earth and all sort of experiment can be conducted with high accuracy, right? So it will be placed in the lower orbit, that is from 340 to 450 kilometers from the Earth surface, and it is designed for the lifespan of around 10 years, but many claim that with maintenance and the repair it could last for more than 15 years also. Okay, so here you can see it is a T-shaped, it is simply T-shaped. So first of all, here you have the Shenzhou, a crew capsule. It is a lifeboat, right? That will be placed in the case of any danger. The astronauts can basically go out of this spacecraft. Okay. Then you have the basically science labs. As I told you, there will be two science labs that will be placed on the both sides. So first is basically Wentian science lab, and second is basically the Magnetian science lab. And then you will have basically the core module that is also known as the Tiane module. Right, this core module is basically the main living area, right? It also includes the main living area where the astronauts will basically live and work, and they conduct the experiments over there, right? And the last figure is basically the robotic cargo ship, right, where, you know, the cargo or some sort of a, you know, items can be docked over there. Okay, next you have the new SEBI rule for the fund transfer compensation. Okay, so first of all, everybody knows about the Security and Exchange Board of India. No problem, I'll explain you. So Security and Exchange Board of India, for the purpose of the asset management company, okay, has set a minimum of 20% of the compensation of the mutual fund managers as well as the other key personals, specifically in the asset management company, right? And the Security and Exchange Board of India has categorically says that there should be a minimum of 20% of the compensation, right, that will be provided to the fund managers and other key personals, right, in the asset management company. That should be formed, right, you know, that should be in the form of the units of the mutual fund schemes they actually manage. Okay, now the Security and the Exchange Board of India is basically, as you know, it's a regulatory body for the securities and the commodity market in India. Right, and the SEBI or Security and Exchange Board of India comes under the jurisdiction of the Ministry of Finance, Government of India. Right, the SEBI is basically established in 1988. Okay, it was set up as a statutory body. Statutory body means it was created with the help of the law which had been passed by the Parliament. So a bill was passed in the Parliament and ultimately assented by the President. That is known as the SEBI Act 1992. So it has been formed under the SEBI Act 1992. So hence it is also known as the statutory body. Okay, now the SEBI basically also clarified that this 20% of the compensation would provided in terms of, you know, the key personals or the mutual fund managers. Now the SEBI also clarified these key personals here refers to the chief executive officer, the chief investment officer, right, as well as the research head, that their direct portfolios. Okay, now let us understand the asset management companies. See again, so asset management companies are basically your firms, or simply you can say they are the company. Okay, these companies basically pool the investment. Pooling the investment means bringing the investment together from various individuals or institutional investors. So they basically pool those investment or pool those investment or funds from various individuals or various institutional investors. Now this company, which is also known as asset investment company, right, they manage the investment which they have recently been pooled by investing in capital assets. So they invest this pooled money in the capital assets. These capital assets are basically, for example, you probably know about the capital assets, like you have the stocks, or you have the real estate, or you have the bonds. Like, these are all the examples of your capital assets. So these company managers basically, you know, use this pooled fund basically in the investing in the capital assets. Or these asset management company have some professionals, right, which are also called the fund managers, right? These fund managers, just like you have seen here in the news, and mutual fund managers, right? Yeah, a similar one. The fund managers basically who decide where this pooled money is invested. So ultimately, the fund managers have the authority to decide where this pooled money will be invested. And the fund managers itself identify, right, the investment options that are in the line with the objective of the investors. So we basically take the investment or the pool the investment in terms of the asset management company from your institutional investors or from investors, basically individual investors, and they basically have certain objectives that, you know, based on that objectives, right, this fund managers basically identify where to invest those pooled money. All right, next, the compensation of the fund managers, at least the variable pay that is linked to the performance of their performance as per the SEBI regulations, right? And the SEBI, which has done here in the crystallization this rules, right, and it has also extended this mandate to the fund managers also and beyond, right, the fund managers, so also called the key employees of the asset management companies also. Now the SEBI has clearly specified that rules of allocation of this 20% compensation, right, it will be proportional to the assets under the management of the scheme, right, in which the employee has the role over the oversight. So it is basically based on, right, the proportion of the asset that the management of the scheme is having oversight over there, okay, and has the role to play over there. And the regulator or the SEBI has also specified that these units offered by the way of compensation that are locked in for the 3 years. So the lock-in period that are there for the 3 years for which the units will be offered. Okay. Next, autonomous vehicles. Now let us understand first the news, or sorry, the basics of the autonomous vehicle, or let us understand first the news. So United Kingdom have become the first country to announce the regulation of the use of self-driving vehicles at a slow speed on the motorways. That means the United Kingdom have been announced, right, the regulations or regulatory framework for the self-driving vehicles that will be run on the motorways at the slow speeds. Okay, so let us understand what is this autonomous vehicles, or what are these self-driving vehicles. So self-driving cars or self-driving vehicles, which are also known as the autonomous vehicles, right, these are basically the driverless car, or simple a robotic car, right, basically is a vehicle that is capable of sensing its environment and moving safely with little or no human input, right? So that is the definition of your, you know, self-driving car. Now the Britain Transport Ministry has said that it has been working basically on the specific update on the country's highway code, right, for basically using for the purpose of this self-driving vehicle system on the roads. Now the ministry or the British Transport Ministry basically use the software or the system called the automated lane keeping system. this automated lane keeping system will be used for the purpose of autonomous vehicles that will be plied on the roads, on the motorable roads, on the motorways, right? These automated lane keeping system basically enable the autonomous vehicles to use the sensors and the softwares to keep the cars within the lane, right? And it will also allow the cars to accelerate and to brake, right, without the driver's input. Okay, so what is this automated lane keeping system? So it's automated lane keeping system enables a vehicle to drive itself in a single lane, right, which is a driverless car, definitely, right, with, you know, while maintaining the ability to easily and safely return control to the driver whenever it is required. Okay, so it will be enabling the vehicle to drive itself on a single lane. Now this technology, which is known as automated lane keeping system, would basically improve the road safety, right? Definitely it will help in reduction of the human error, because the human error contributes to around 85% of the road accidents basically, and also led to the majority of the fatalities on the roads. All right, the use of this automated, you know, the lane keeping system, which is also known as ALKS, should be restricted to the motorways, right, which is basically not very high speed. That means up to the speed of 60 kilometers per hour. Okay, now the UK government has already want to bring this autonomous driving technology, right, and for that purpose the Transport Ministry of the UK has already forecast that by 2035 around 40% of the new UK cars, that means the 40% of the new cars that will be purchased in the UK by 2035, that would be the self-driving capabilities. That means the people will be purchasing around 40% of the cars that will be having the self-driving capabilities. And this autonomous vehicle segment would produce around 38,000 new skill jobs in the UK alone. Okay, but you must also understand that there is also an inherent danger with autonomous vehicles. For example, the Tesla's driver assistant tools, where the autopilot system have been working for, you know, bringing this technology on the roads of the US, is basically having around 20 crashes on the roads. So apparently you must understand that there are dangers of these autonomous vehicles, because sometimes that may happen that, you know, the drivers apparently misunderstand the limits of the technology. The technology has the limits, right? And it may also be misused by some, you know, by the hackers also for the purpose of, you know, purposefully crashing or purposefully, you know, colliding the cars with each other, right? All sort of dangers were still there. Okay, so here you have the model where you will have the forward fencing camera to capture the images. Then you have the LiDAR system that will be connected to the satellites, right? Then you have the radar sensors that will be sensing, you know, the vehicle that are coming from the backward side, and the self-driving sensors, right, that will be basically taking care of the front side of the car, right, to accelerate and to brake, all sort of things. Okay, next, the Karen people. Okay, first of all, as already you probably know about the Myanmar, right, the Myanmar, the army has taken over the civilian government, right? So the armed forces have been taken over the civilian government, and the elected government, right, as well as its leader like Aung San Suu Kyi, have been recently been arrested, right, by the military authorities. Now there are many such minority groups in the Myanmar which are basically agitating against this military coup, where the military has taken over the elected government of Myanmar. So there are two major minority groups which are basically using the guerrilla warfare tactics, right, to capture some of the, basically, you know, the authorities which have been captured by the Myanmarese army. So the two such ethnic groups are basically known as the Karen. The Karen basically is basically one such ethnic group, and the second is basically also known as, you know, the another group where, you know, basically Kanchen, the Karen and Kachin. These are the basically two groups which are the ethnic groups which are basically found in you know, in the Myanmar, which are also, you know, showing the resistance to the Myanmarese army against such, illegal capturing of the power by the military chief of Myanmar. Okay, so one such ethnic group people is also known as the Karen, which using the guerrilla warfare to capture the Myanmarese army base, right, which is located near the border of Thailand. Okay, now you must understand there is an organization called KNU. The KNU means, that is Karen National Union. The Karen National Union, right? I'll let you know what is Karen National Union. So Karen National Union basically is belong to, you know, this Karen people, which is the ethnic people reside in Myanmar, right? So this Karen National Union basically controls the territory in the eastern Myanmar, that is nearby your the Thailand, right? Thailand border. Now they are showing the heavy resistance against this military coup or military takeover, where the elected government have been unseated by the military, right? And basically this KNU is nothing but and is basically an arm wing of the Karen National Liberation Army. So what is KNU? KNU refers to the Karen National Union. It is basically a political organization where, right, which is having its arm wing, that is the Karen National Liberation Army. Okay, and the Karen National Union, you know, they claim to represent the Karen people of Myanmar, right? And the Karen National Union basically operate in the mountainous, you know, regions, in specifically in the eastern Myanmar, and they have some underground networks, right? Specifically, you know, in these areas, in those mountainous areas nearby the Thailand border, right? And in the Karen language, they are also known as Kautului, right? And these Karen basically led primarily by the Karen National Union. And they are waging the war against such coup against specifically the central government since 1949, right? The main purpose of the Karen National Union is to get independence from the Myanmar. And since 1976 onward, this armed group, that is also known as the Karen National Liberation Army, is called for the federal system rather than the independent state. So they have changed their, you know, their tactic of from being, you know, from demanding the independent state to the federal state. Okay, and there is similar situation specifically, you know, in the northern Myanmar, where one more ethnic group, that is called Kachin, the Kachin minority, also claims to be captured several government outposts, right? It is happening because they are again agitated because of, you know, this coup, military coup that has been happened in the Myanmar. So another ethnic group, the Kachin minority, basically claim that they have captured the several government outposts specifically, you know, in this region, right? And these two ethnic groups, the Karen and the Kachin, are basically the two bigger minority groups that have been seeking greater autonomy for the decades together, right? And they were basically also involved in some sort of an armed conflict, but now some sort of a ceasefire have been maintained between those groups and the government of Myanmar. So the Karen is nothing but they are the ethno-linguistic group that are basically resides in the Sino-Tibetan border. So they speak basically the Sino-Tibetan language, right? And they reside primarily in the Kien state in the southern and the southeastern Myanmar region. Okay, if you want to know more about this Kachin minority group, so Kachin minority group basically encompasses the number of ethnic groups that basically speaks the dozens of the distinct language, right? But these language all belongs to, you know, the Sino-Tibetan language. So they are basically the Sino-Tibetan, the language groups. And these same region or these same people, basically they belong to the Tibeto-Burman linguistic family, who basically inhabit in some region in the northern part of, you know, Burma, which is basically bordered with the China. Okay, now you must also understand what is their demography specifically. So the exact figure about how much the population of this Kachin people is there, it is unknown, right? So there is no reliable census data on their figure, right, about these ethnic groups in the Burma, right? But most of the estimates suggest that they are basically roughly around 1 million, you know, Kachin people in the Myanmar. So roughly their population is around 10 lakh or 1 million, right? The Kachin as well as the Chin, right? They are basically the Burma's largest Christian minority. So the countries are basically primarily the Christian minorities, right? And generally speaking, you can say that around 2/3 or 90% of the countries are basically Christians, right? So 90% of the countries are basically Christians. They follow the Christianity, and remaining one, around 10%, follows the Buddhism in the Myanmar. Okay, so here you have the political map of Myanmar, where the Karen state basically shown by some sort of a political thinkers. All right, next. Okay, so this Karen state I was talking about, this is basically shown with the help of these, you know, in between Myanmar and your Thailand. Okay, next, the global immunization strategy. Okay, so first of all, the WHO or World Health Organization had unveiled the global immunization strategy, right? As you know that because of this COVID-19 pandemic, right, there is disruption in the basically immunization that has to be taken place to the millions of the children's worldwide. Now there is a disruption, right, because of the COVID-19 pandemic and lockdowns and lot of other issues. Now the WHO has unveiled this global immunization strategy to vaccinate around 50 million children and to save around 50 million life worldwide by 2030, right? Because you must understand that without vaccination, right, definitely these children will not be in the safer hand. So this strategy, which is led by the UN-led global immunization strategy, have been unveiled to reach out more than 50 million children, right? So these more than 50 million children will be provided the vaccination. Now you must understand that will be missing the life-saving drugs, right? Because of this coronavirus, lockdowns. Now these life-saving drugs, like, you know, for the measles, right, for the other diseases, that will be provided to the children. Now the WHO or World Health Organization, along with the UNICEF and the Vaccine Alliance, which is also known as Gavi, right, that will be, you know, providing this strategy, right, that will basically potentially save around 50 million lives, right, in the worldwide related to these diseases, right? As you know about the WHO, the World Health Organization is basically a specialized agency of the United Nations, which are responsible for the international public health. Okay, as you know about the UNICEF, see, UNICEF is also, the full form is United Nations Children Fund. Yeah, UNICEF is also the United Nations agency which is responsible for providing the humanitarian and the development aid to the children's worldwide. Okay, and Gavi, the Gavi means it is basically the officially basically is also known as the Vaccine Alliance. Okay, it's a simple, you can understand, it's a public private, you know, global health partnership. Okay, with the goal of increasing access to the immunization, specifically the vaccination, in the poor countries, right? And the Gavi has its headquarters in Geneva, which is basically located in Switzerland. Okay, now the WHO chief, you know, Tedros Adhanom, you know, Ghebreyesus, basically have recently said that because of the multiple outbreaks of life-threatening disease like measles, yellow fever, and the, you know, diphtheria, right, there is also ensuring that the routine vaccination services would definitely protect especially the poor countries where this vaccination schedule is disrupted, right? So the WHO survey basically shows that around 1/3 of the countries are still, you know, have been disrupted because of this COVID pandemic, right? So there is disruptions in the routine immunization services. So the joint statement, which is basically shows that around 60 mass vaccination camps are basically currently postponed because of the corona, specifically in the 50 countries. That postponement of the vaccination schedule has led to, right, putting around 228 million people life, specifically the children's life, at the risk because of the measles, polio, yellow fever, diphtheria, right, all sort of vaccine prevented disease can be there. But now because of the postponement of this vaccination, around 228 million children are basically, you know, they are at the risk of catching this disease, right? And that's all, right? Next, the Net Zero Producers Forum. what is net zero produces forum. So first of all, let us understand the news, then we'll understand what is this net zero producers forum. Okay, so first of all, the Saudi Arabia has recently joined, you know, the United States, Canada, Norway and Qatar, right? These four countries that basically form the net zero producers forum, right? The Saudi Arabia recently been susceptible about the joining of this net zero producers forum, right? Why is susceptible? Because it is basically the largest producer of the crude oil specifically in the world. So, but now Saudi Arabia has said that it will join the net zero producers forum for oil and gas producers, right? And they will also support the implementation of the Paris Agreement for the climate change. Okay, so now the Canada, Norway, Qatar, Saudi Arabia and United States, they are collectively representing around 40% of the global oil and gas production. I'll repeat again, Canada, Norway, Qatar, Saudi Arabia and United States. They roughly account for 40% of, you know, the global oil and gas production. Now they will come together to form a cooperative forum, right, that will basically develop a pragmatic, you know, net zero emission strategy, right, in the form of the net zero production forum, right, that include the methane abatement, right, that also include the advancing of circular carbon, you know, economy approach, that also includes the development and the deployment of the clean energy, right, that also include the carbon capture, that also includes some sort of a development of the storage technology, that also include, you know, diversification from the reliance on the hydrocarbon, you know, to basically to you know, the basically non-polluting sources, right? And there are many other objective, many other measures that will be taken under net zero production forum. So Saudi Arabia, which is the largest or world largest crude oil exporter, will be a part of this new platform, right? Here they will discuss the way to achieve the net zero carbon emission target to limit the global warming specifically, you know, in the world. Okay, now in the past, the Saudi Arabia's crown prince Mohammed bin Salman has said that the kingdom or Saudi Arabia kingdom is aiming to reduce the carbon emissions, right? How it will reduce? By generating 50% of the country's energy from renewables by 2030. Now, the Joe Biden, which is the current US president, has already, you know, unveiled the plan to cut down emissions by 50% to 52% from 2005 levels in the country, right? As the two-day climate summit that was basically kicked off with the help of the world leaders that was attended by, you know, around 40 countries. It was attended virtually by the leaders from these 40 countries. All right. So here the net zero production producers forum, as I told you that it has different, you know, other aspects like the methane abatement, right, the circular economy, circular carbon economy approach, right, then the development, the deployment of clean energy and the carbon capture and the storage technology, just I was explaining you, the diversification from the reliance of the hydrocarbon revenue to basically some sort of a cleaner technologies, you know, the revenue development, that will be basically some sort of a the ways by which it can be relied. Okay, next, the MAX 1047. See, MAX 1047 is a basically the new high yielding variety of soybean. So it's simply a variety of soybean. Okay, this is simply a variety of soybean. Now this variety basically also known as the high yielding and is also pest resistant. So it's a hybrid variety of soybean which has been recently developed by the Indian scientists. Okay, now this newly developed variety, which is also known as MACS 1407, is basically suitable for the cultivation in the different states like Assam, in the West Bengal, in the Jharkhand, in the Chhattisgarh and then the northeastern states, right? So it will be it can be grown in several states in the several agroclimatic zones, and the seeds, right, belong to this soybean will be made available to the farmers for the sowing season for 2022 Kharif season, where it will be shown on the fields. Okay, and as you know that in 2019 the India produced around 90 million tons of the soybean, that is the production, right, of the soybean in India, right? And this cultivated basically, you know, widely as, you know, as also considered as a cheap source of the protein, specifically for animal feed, right? And also it will be used as a packaged meals also, right? And also you must also understand that India is also striving to become the world, you know, largest producer, or among the one of the world largest producers in the world. Now this high yielding and the disease resistant, pest resistant variety of the soybean, right, would definitely help in achieving this target of being the target of becoming, you know, one among the world largest producer of the soybean, right, to fulfill all sort of a protein requirement in the animal diet and the packaged meals, right? So it has been developed by the Agarkar Research Institute, Pune, right, which is an autonomous institute under the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, definitely with the collaboration of Indian Council of Agricultural Research, right, which had developed this technology. Okay, so here you can see the new varieties of soybean. Next, the first ever electric tractor. Okay, so the India has produced the first ever electric tractor. So here, this tractor was tested by the Central Farm Machinery Training and Testing Institute, that is located in the Budni in the Madhya Pradesh, has tested this first ever electric tractor in the institute. Okay, now the Central Farm Machinery Training and Testing Institute is it's a premier institute under Ministry of Agriculture and the Farmers Welfare. Now the institute basically receives an application for the electric tractor under confidential text initially, and under this mandate the institute basically tested this tractor, right? And the institute has already tested this tractor and also released the draft test report based on this test which was conducted by the institute, right? And this has been basically tested as per the Central Farm Machinery Training and the Testing Institute, right, which have tested and which have also obtained the NABL certificate of accreditation, right, for the purpose of the CMVR test laboratory on 30th of the March 2021, right? So this has been obtained, the certificate also, from NABL. Now the electric tractor will also be more environmental friendly because it will definitely reduce the emissions in terms of the greenhouse gas emissions. Now let us understand what is this NABL certificate of the accreditation for the test. The NABL certification, basically the NABL stands for the National Accreditation, the National Accreditation Board of Testing and Calibration Laboratories. It is simply NABL, right? So it is simply the National Accreditation Board of Testing and the Calibration Technologies Laboratory. It's basically accreditation body, right? With its accreditation system, which is established under the ISO 17011 framework, right? It is basically a conformity assessment requirement for the accreditation bodies, which are accrediting the conformity assessment, you know, for the different types of technologies. For example, if you are testing the technologies or testing technology in accordance with ISO 17025, right? So the different type of code. So if you are testing the Indian standard, you know, that is ISO, that is 17025, that is the general requirement for the testing and calibration laboratories. If you are testing basically according to ISO 17025, right, that is basically requirement for, you know, the calibration laboratories. And if you are testing for medical testing laboratories, that is as per 15189, right? So that is for quality and the competence, the medical testing laboratories will be done. Then if you are testing for the proficiency test providers, that will be provided in accordance to 17043, that will be in accordance with the testing. And the last is basically the reference material. The reference material producers, it is there on the website of the National Accreditation Board of Testing and the Calibration Laboratories. You can also go through, right? So there ISO 17034 is related to the reference material producers, right? So you just go through the website of NABL, just type on the Google on the NABL, because this type of the ISO framework is very important for the prelims point of view, because in the UPSC they can directly ask you what stand for ISO 17025, 15189, 17035. They can directly ask you, right? So go to NABL website, type about us, right? You just click on there and you will get this information over there. Okay. So here the first lactic detector which has been recently been tested. Okay. Next, the world oldest water. Now, the world oldest water have been recently been found in the Canadian Shield, right? Basically in the Canadian Shield. Now it has been found in basically in the Shield, which will also bring some light on the beginning of the life, right? So this water is around 1.6 billion years old. Now it is the oldest water that is found in our planet. Now the Canadian geologists have recently been discovered this, basically that, you know, specifically it will be useful for, you know, for the marsh also, right? This discovery was made by Dr. Barbara Sherwood Lawler, which is basically University of Toronto, right, who basically working in this project since 2019. Now she is extracting this water basically in 2009, right, from the Canadian mine water, and she has basically found that it is basically around 1.6 billion years old, which is basically the oldest water which is found on the surface. Now she also discovered this water basically which is claimed to be taken from 2.4 kilometers below the Earth's surface, right? It has been of great importance because it will be of greater interest for the origin and the evolution of our planet, how they have evolved, right? And it will also bring the light on the nature of the water and the life that was there at that point of the time, right? And it also, you know, shed the light on the possibility of the finding life on the marsh. Okay, Miss Sherwood Lawler, which is basically carrying out this research at the Kidd's Creek mine, which is located in the Canadian Shield. So the Canadian Shield is around 2.7 billion years old, right? Which is the world largest continental shield, one among the world largest continental shield, and which is also the oldest and least tectonic active part of Earth crust. The shield, which is a geographical term or geological term, you can understand, the shield is basically a large area, right, which is area which is exposed of the pre-Cambrian crystalline igneous or the high-grade metamorphic rocks, right? These shields are generally tectonically stable. Tectonically stable means there is no seismic activities, right, on this shield. And these shields are basically, or the rocks which are there on the shield are basically older than 570 million years, you know, that is something around, you know, the pre-Cambrian, you know, the igneous or, you know, the metamorphic rocks that may be, you know, around 570 million years ago, or it can be as old as around 2 to 3.5 billion years ago also. So that means the age on the shield vary from 570 million years to around 3.5 billion years also. So age also varies on the shield, but definitely the rocks which are found on the shield is also most stable. They are tectonically stable, right? They are not tectonically active. They are least tectonically active. They are the oldest part of the Earth. And the shields also found in almost all continents throughout the world. Okay. Now researchers who are working on this project, they have collected the sample, right? And they have found that it is around 1.6 billion years ago, right? And the investigations are on basically into this highly saline water, which led to this path-breaking discovery. So which have basically found this chemolithotropic microbes, which is a basically bacteria that can thrive in the most extreme surrounding, right, which have basically, you know, gave this contribution specifically to this study. So let us understand first what is this, you know, the chemolithotropic microbes. So chemolithotropes basically are the group of the phylogenetically diverse microbes. Simply, they are microbes that can obtain their energy specifically, you know, from the oxidation of the inorganic compound. That means for the purpose of growth, for the purpose of the development, they obtain the energy from the oxidation of inorganic compounds such as the hydrogen sulfide or reduced metals. That means they receive their energy from the oxidation of, you know, inorganic compounds. Okay. That means the inorganic compounds, like you have the hydrogen, you have the hydrogen sulfide, or you have some sort of a metals, right, in the reduced form. Okay. And the term that is called chemolithotropy basically describes this energy metabolism of these bacteria that can basically rely in the absence of light, use this tactic called the oxidation of this inorganic substances as a source of their energy for their cell biosynthesis as well as for their maintenance. All right. So I hope it is clear. So this Canadian Shield, I have told you that it is basically where this kid mine is located. From there, this water is basically collected, right? Over the millions of years of the flux, right, there is horizontal seabed that become now vertical, and now this water is basically preserved in this strata, all right. So here you can understand the researchers are working to collect this water. All right, next, Ayush 64. See, Ayush 64 is basically a name of a drug, right, which is claimed by the Central Council of Research in the Ayurvedic Sciences that this herbal medication, right, would definitely protect the patients or would definitely help in the treatment of asymptomatic, mild and the moderate COVID-19 infection, right? So that IO64 is a drug that will be useful for the treatment of asymptomatic, mild and moderate COVID-19 infections. So Ayush Ministry have recently been, have claimed for that purpose. Okay, so IOS 64, as I told you, is a polyherbal formulation which is developed by the Central Council for Research in the Ayurvedic Sciences. Now let us understand brief about this Central Council for Research in Ayurvedic Sciences. So the Central Council for Research in Ayurvedic Sciences, which is also known as CCRAS, it's nothing but it's an autonomous body, right, belong to the Ministry of Ayush. Ministry of Ayush, everybody knows about. A stand for Ayurveda, Y stand for Yoga and Naturopathy, right? U stand for Unani, S stand for Siddha, and H stand for Homeopathy, right? So the Central Council of Research in Ayurvedic Sciences is basically an autonomous body under the Ministry of Ayush, under Government of India. So you can understand that it is an apex body in India for the formulation, for the coordination, for the development, and for the promotion of the research, specifically in the Ayurveda as well as in the SOAR ecosystem of medicine. So initially this IOS-64, this drug was basically developed for the malaria in the year 1980. Now it will be repurposed for the purpose of the COVID-19 infection. So here it is basically the Ayurvedic anti-malaria drug that will be now used for the treatment of COVID-19 also. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow for our next Current Affairs. Take care of yourself. Thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you.